1 Corinthians 15:58. The Bible says, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." Let's pray. Lord, we love you. I thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. God, I just ask you to help me, Lord. Speak through me. Use me, Lord. Use this to help us be steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in your work. We need to be reminded of that often. God, we can get discouraged. We can just get lazy. We can get busy. God, we can be moved from what and where we should stand. So please just help us, challenge us in this time. And God, we thank you that, Lord, you didn't stay dead. You rose from the dead, giving us victory. We praise you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The title of this is Our Stand Because of the Gospel. And what is the gospel? So we're in 1 Corinthians 15. We're going to kind of do a run through 1 Corinthians 15 here real quick to build up to that last verse, in verse 58, because he says there in verse 58, "Therefore, my beloved brethren." So he's saying, because of all of this, I like what one preacher said, when you see a therefore, look what it's there for. So look before it and see what it's there for. So why is it there? Well, that's what 1 Corinthians 15 is about, and it's really essentially because of the gospel. So because of what God did through the gospel, and we'll look at what the gospel is, but because of everything that God did because of the gospel, he says, here's what you should do. It's our, as Romans 12 says, this is your reasonable service. It's reasonable and acceptable for you to serve God in this manner, that you would be a living sacrifice. It's reasonable. That you would die to yourself. It's reasonable. What God asks of us is not unreasonable. It's reasonable. It's the least we could do. In one of the parables, I believe Jesus is telling, and he says, you know, when the unprofitable servant has done his duty, he's still unprofitable. When we've done what God commands us to do, he says we're still unprofitable. Like, amen. Then I'm shooting for that unprofitable, that type of unprofitable status if I can, okay? Not the other ones, but you know what I'm saying? If you get what I'm saying, I want to be that at the very least, just do what God has commanded me. Man, I fall short of that. We need his help. So our stand because of the gospel. So what is the gospel? Well, we can see that 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is a definitive chapter on the gospel, or many would say the resurrection, but that is the gospel. The gospel is defined for us in the first four verses. It is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's what we're most people are celebrating today. But by the way, we celebrate that every Sunday. Did you know that? That's why we meet on Sunday. We don't meet on Saturday. That was the Jews. That was the day of cessation. The eighth day, so if you start on Sunday, that's the first day, right? And you go all the way through the week to the seventh day, that's the Sabbath, that's Saturday, that's the seventh day, the last day. But then you get to that eighth day, or you could say Sunday, the first day again. But if you look at it, the eighth day, it's a new beginning. That's when the Lord was resurrected, was on the eighth day, that new day, the first day of the week. That's why we meet on Sunday, because every week we celebrate the resurrection. And I have no problem with us giving special emphasis to it, you know, one time a year at this time. That we should, amen. I'm glad that people focus on it at least one time a year. Gives us an opportunity to talk to them about it and opens up the door to share the gospel with them. But here's what it is. This definitive chapter tells us about the resurrection. If you would, 1 Corinthians 15, really 3 and 4. Paul says, I'm going to declare unto you the gospel in verse 1. And then verse 3, he starts doing it. He says, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. So he received it from Christ. You can look that up in Galatians. How that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Verse 4, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That's the gospel, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. See, our Savior didn't stay dead. It's not that we have a dead Savior. We have a living Savior. That's the power of the gospel right there, is that he resurrected. That's what gives us the victory, is that he resurrected, and we'll get that one day too. Praise the Lord. Amen. But it defines the gospel there. And then First, chapter 15 goes on to defend the gospel, and he gives these eyewitness accounts of, at one point, verse 6 says, he was seen after his resurrection of above 500 brethren at once. He's defending the gospel. So there's 500 eyewitnesses that saw him alive at one time. More than that, but just at that one time. So he defends the gospel. And then he talks about the despair without the gospel, verses 12 to 19. If there's no resurrection, then he says we're found of all men most miserable. And our faith is in vain. It's for nothing. If Christ didn't resurrect from the dead, what are we doing here? What are we doing here? This is meaningless. This is pointless if he's not resurrected. If you don't believe he's resurrected, go home. Because you're wasting your time. Our faith is in vain. He says in verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. He says, how miserable? What's the point in that? So there's despair without the gospel. And then verses 20 to 25, the delivering up of the kingdom because of the gospel. Verses 26 to 34, learning to live as a dead man because of the gospel. Verses 35 to 50, the power of our resurrection because of the gospel. And then 51 to 57, the victory that is found in the gospel. It's because of all those things, because of all that God's done for us. I love verse 57, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. See, because he isn't still dead, we aren't of all men most miserable. We have victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what the resurrection's about. That's what the gospel's about. Victory over sin and death. He defeated it. He put the death blow on Satan. He crushed his head, and we have the victory. Well, that's why we sing victory in Jesus. Because in Jesus, we have the victory. We've already won. We're more than conquerors. So it's because of all that he says, therefore, because of these things, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Because of that, he says, here's what I want. This is God telling us this. He says, therefore, since Christ has done all this for you, this is what I want from you. So let me ask you, as we get into this message here, as you look at what Christ did for us, and we take this special time right now to focus on that, and we think of the beating that he's given, and I preached on that before, it was gruesome and just horrible. We wouldn't even want to picture it. We wouldn't want to see it. As gross and grotesque as it would be, his flesh being ripped open and just the blood just pouring out. I mean, think about that. And then watching him get his hands and his feet nailed to the cross. And his body weight is resting on those nails. I mean, it's just ripping at you. And every breath he has to take, he's got to push himself up to take a breath. And then he lets himself go. And you eventually die in crucifixion through asphyxiation. You just can't breathe anymore. Because you get so weak, you can't lift yourself up anymore. So you're there, knowing you need a breath and you can't take it. You ever been in a pool or something, someone maybe holding you down under and you're like, or maybe no one's holding you down under, but you're in the ocean or something, you're fighting to get back to the top. Maybe you went down to, you jumped in the deep end and you wanted to push yourself all the way down so you could sit on the bottom. And then you're like running out of breath and you shoot to the top because your body's just screaming, just give me air, give me air. It's screaming inside of you and you just can't wait to just get above water and just take in that breath. Now imagine what's going on in your mind when it's just been maybe just like 30 seconds too long, however long it's been, and you're needing air, you're needing to breathe, and you're there in that situation and your body's just screaming for it. And you can't wait to get up so you can take that breath. But put yourself on a cross. Where your hands are out, you're being outstretched like this, and you're so weak, you know you need a breath, but you don't have the energy to do it anymore. And your body's telling you, just lift, you need to breathe, you need this air, you have to have this to live. Just lift yourself. And your body's saying, I can't. And your mind's screaming at you, just do it, you have to do it, just do it. And your body says, I can't. And your mind inside is screaming at you, and you finally just a little bit, and then you collapse again. You're pushing up on nails in your feet. Think about the pain every time. And his back's already all chewed up. We talk about an old rugged cross. You know, a lot of times you go into churches, they have this nice polished cross and it looks all beautiful and smooth. No. You ever been running your hand along a piece of wood and you get a fat splinter in you? I mean, one of those fat ones that goes deep and like hits the bone and you're, ah! And that thing just hurts for days. You pull it out. And it's still hurting days later. You touch and you're just, it's sore. And he's on an old rugged cross. And every time he needs a breath, he's the back, his back that's been all chewed up. How many of us have been riding our bike as a kid? You fall off your bike and just road rash all over. I mean, rocks, asphalt, everything's just stuck in your knee. You done that before? And then after that, you're like, you know, if you're around your friends, you're trying not to cry. They're like, you all right? You're like, yeah! You know, and you're like, you're going away from them so they don't see like a tear coming down or something. I mean, because you're fighting it, you know, and then now you got to do the ride home. And you're riding home. And you're just like, you got your shorts or whatever, your pants pulled up because you don't want nothing touching it. I mean, nothing touching that cut. And then you're going and you get going faster and the wind's hitting it and you're just like, you don't want nothing hitting it, nothing touching it. And that's just a little cut right here. But now imagine your back's all chewed up and to breathe, you have to just. And that's what our Savior went through. That's what he was facing on that cross. That's everything that he was going through. Doing all of that for us. Now when we think about that, that's what he did for me. We get to verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, says because of all he did, because of the gospel, can you be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord? For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Where do we stand in our service for Christ? Where do we stand in our love for the Lord? Are we steadfast? Are we unmovable? Are we always abounding in the work of the Lord? Think about that. Always, not sometimes, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because of what he did. Therefore, because he went through that, do you do this? And ask yourself, because of what the Lord did, what do I do? Do I just live my life of ease? And just go about my life and give some credit to the Lord, but mostly it's just about me and what I want? Or are we steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord? What is it that the gospel should cause us to do? Where should we stand? Does the resurrection of Christ have any bearing on what we are and where we stand? Think about it. Because of the resurrection, we should stand strong in the faith and always serve God. That's what he's saying right there. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because of the resurrection, because of the gospel, we should stand strong in the faith and always serve God. We don't have a dead, meaningless faith. Because of the resurrection, we can and should live new lives in Christ. That's what it is. It gives us new life. That's what that baptism pictures. It's us saying, I'm dead to the old man. I'm going to live. I'm telling all of you that I'm going to live a new life in Christ. I'm going to live for him. I'm going to always abound, be steadfast and unmovable and always abound in the work of the Lord. When you get baptized in those waters, that's what you're telling everybody. That's what I'm going to do. That's what I want to do. Do you? That's what we need to do. We're living new lives in Christ. We shouldn't make excuses for why we sin, but strive to die daily. Not make excuses for our sin. We're in an excuse-riddled society. I mean, all of us. And we have to pull back from that. We got to like just sometimes step back and say, all right, I need to just like clear my mind and just think. And how are these things affecting me and even the manner in which I think? And pull ourselves back. Here's what Paul said in verse 31. I protest by your rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. Paul says, I got to take care of this thing every day. He said, I die daily because of what my Lord did for me. Because of everything that he did. So where should our stand for Christ start? Our stand in the gospel starts by being steadfast and unmovable. Verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, That's where we need to stand, being steadfast and unmovable, knowing what we believe, knowing where we're at. I can't get that through enough, that you know what you believe. You know why you believe it. This is why I had a King James Bible conference, so we know why we believe the King James Bible. Not just, well, my preacher says so, I don't know, I don't get it. But that's where our church stands. No, that's not what I want. I don't ever want that. I want you to know what you believe. Amen. Know why you believe it. That's why we do these things. That's why I teach and preach the way I do. I hope I teach you and I hope you get it and you hold on to it. And you're steadfast and unmovable. If you don't ever get it, you'll never stand for it. You will not stand for it if you don't own it. It's got to be personal to you. It's got to be something that you want to hold on to. Because you love God. You say, I want to know what God says about this. Amen. But most of the time, here's what we say. Is we're like, man, well, I enjoy doing this. I don't want to know what God says about that. Anybody else ever said that? Yeah. I have. Amen. Learned some things in the Bible. I'm like, wish I didn't read that one. That's not what we need. We need to say, hey, what does God say about this? Let me fix my life to match this. That's right. To match what the Lord says. Amen. That's how you can be steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, by owning it, by holding it, by loving it. If we're to be steadfast, it has to be built and based on keeping God's word. If you would, turn to Psalm 78, verse 7. Psalm chapter 78, verse 7. If we are to be steadfast, it has to be built and based on keeping God's word. Psalm 78, verse 7 says, let me just turn there, I have it printed. No, I'm good. I've got it printed here. It says that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep His commandments, and might not be as their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation that set not their heart aright and whose spirit was not steadfast with God. Their spirit was not steadfast with God. What did they do? They forgot the works of God. They didn't keep His commandments. It says, I'm challenging you. He says, I don't want you to be like this and might not be as their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation. Don't be like your fathers. Don't be stubborn and rebellious. Keep His commandments. So if we're to be steadfast, then we have to build that on keeping God's word. Amen. Not trying to justify why we don't have to. Not trying to get out of it. You can make the Bible say whatever you want. If you want it to say something, you can make it say that. But is that the Christian that says, therefore, I'm going to be always abounding. Unmovable. Steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because of all that God did for me, that's where I want to be. That's a sold out Christian. That's where we need to be. That's where God wants every one of us. And when we're not there, that we'd repent and get that thing right. That's what God's looking for from us. That's what the victory of the resurrection means. I don't have to stay stuck in my sin. I can get beyond that. God gives me the power to get beyond it. Through the resurrection of Christ, He gives me the power to live for Him, the power to move forward. And I don't have to stay there. I can go forward in victory. Our steadfastness is built on a heart that's right with God's word. You're in Psalm 78, go to verse 37. Verse 8 also said the same thing, a generation that set not their heart aright and whose spirit was not steadfast with God. So it deals with our heart. Look, and it always comes back to that. It's always a heart issue. Where's your heart? Look, if you don't desire the things of God and following after the Lord and walking with Him, then it's in your heart. Then your heart isn't right with God. And sometimes we need to just get alone with God and say, God, my heart's not right with you. Help me get it right. I don't know why I'm fighting you. But just lay it out there. Say, I don't want to do this. I'm sick of it. Whatever it is. I don't know what the deal is, but just be honest with God. He already knows. Just be honest with Him. Tell Him if you're like, I don't understand this. I don't get this. I'm frustrated with this, God, whatever it may be. Or, God, this has my heart. I'm thinking about this thing all the time, Lord. So there, my heart's not set on you. They set not their heart aright, and whose spirit was not steadfast with God. Now verse 37. For their heart was not right with him, neither were they steadfast in his covenant. It's amazing how he just keeps saying the same thing over and over in Psalm chapter 78. He's telling them, hey, this is the wilderness wanderings. Here's what the problem was. Here's what they were doing wrong. Their heart was not right with him, neither were they steadfast in his covenant. See, they weren't set on his word. Are we set on his word? Are we really building our lives on the book? Are you building your life on this book? Here's the danger we have to watch for. Don't let your Christianity just become routine. You have to fight that. Because it does. I mean, we've got, you know, we meet Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. We go soul winning on Saturdays. I mean, it can become routine. Don't let that happen. That's why you have to stay engaged yourself. You've got to stay in this thing yourself, getting something from it, asking God to show you some things so it doesn't become stagnant. So you're not just like, here we go, and it just becomes a routine. Fight that. Don't let that happen. Hey, push yourself out of your comfort zone. Amen. Make yourself do something you don't want to do. Say, I don't want to do that. I'm scared. Good, go do it. Say, what? No, I can't do that. Hey, invite someone that you work with to church when you're scared to death to do it. Somebody at school, you're scared to death to do it. Invite them. Amen. Next week, plan it. Take an invitation. I don't have them at home. Here, I'll bring them home back tonight. But grab one. Grab one of these. It don't matter. Invite them. You say, I'm scared. Good. It'll help you. It'll build your faith. Something that simple will build your faith. Push yourself out of your comfort zones, because we get comfortable with stuff and we're just like, oh, I'm comfortable here and I'm serving God, so I'm comfortable here. But is that what 1 Corinthians 15:58 said? No. Let's jump back and look at that. I've been butchering it all day, so I'm not going to just try and quote it. 1 Corinthians 15:58 says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Look, is that someone that's abounding in the work of the Lord? Do they say, oh man, I'm serving God now, I'm comfortable here, let's just put it on cruise, and I'm just going to stay right here? Does that sound like someone that's abounding in the work of the Lord? I mean, I think of abounding. I think of, yes, I'm bounding. I'm abounding. I'm jumping. I'm moving. I mean, that's what I think of when I think of abounding. You're getting going. You're doing more. You're excited. You're jumping. And you're, yes, let's abound in this thing. Let's do it more and more and more. That's what I think of when I think of abounding. Amen. That's what someone abounding in the work of the Lord is doing. It's not just, oh, we're here and we're just going to stay here. Man, I'm telling you, pray right now. Start praying right now for this church we're going to start. I don't know when it's going to happen, amen, but we're planning it. I'd like to do it by next April. I would like to do it by then. That's what I'm asking God for. Will we? I don't know. I can't say. That's what I'm asking for. Why? Because I want to keep abounding in the work of the Lord. Therefore, because he did all this for me, because the gospel represents all of this for me, that we looked at in 1 Corinthians 15, because of that, I want to always abound in the work of the Lord. And I've got to make myself, I've got to fight it, because I don't always want to. Right. I don't always want to. I'm telling you, we went out soul winning Thursday. I didn't want to. Amen. I didn't. I was at home. I was comfortable. I'm like, well, let's go now. But praise God, I'm glad we did. Went out Saturday. I mean, praise the Lord, the people who went out Saturday were such a blessing, had great attitudes. It was awesome. I loved it. We had four people, prayed, asked Christ to save them, made a profession of faith. And the best part of all of that was that I didn't lead one of them. Right. Amen. It was you guys. I pray for that. I pray for that. I said, God, let them lead people to you. I mean, I want to too, but I want you guys too, because I want you to stay encouraged in it. And I love seeing that. I love that everyone was out there being a part of that, just involved in it. Amen. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. I know we get here sometimes, we don't always want to be here. I understand that. I get it. I've been there. Look, I'm the pastor. I don't always want to be here. Now, 99% of the time, I do want to. But there's sometimes, hey, maybe there was something going on at home. You know, leave the house mad. And here we are, show up, and it's like, all right, we're here. Smile, everyone. No, I'm just kidding. We don't do that. Okay, that's not true either. You better be happy. You're going to be happy, and you're going to like it. No. Abounding in the work of the Lord. Sometimes we got to make ourselves do that. But we're to be unmovable, steadfast. So if we're to be steadfast, it has to be on the Word of God. A wrong heart won't believe God. Verse 32 of Psalm 78. For all this they sin still and believe not for his wondrous works. A wrong heart will not believe what God says. A wrong heart, hey, it might not be wicked and malicious, and say, I don't believe that. That's a bunch of garbage. But it might be like this. Well, God can't use me. I'm not, you know, I don't know how to talk like some people. God can't use me. I could never do that. So you don't believe God? That's what that is. See, it doesn't have to be malicious like we think of an atheist. It doesn't have to be like that. A heart of unbelief can be like, oh, I just couldn't do that. Well, didn't God command you to go? I mean, there's things God's asked us to do. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Now, that's hard right there. How many things have we done not in faith? Whoo, man, more than I'm afraid to answer for that one to the Lord. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. But look, if we're not trusting God, then that's our hearts not right with Him. We're not going to be steadfast. A wrong heart will lie to God. Verse 36, nevertheless, they did flatter Him with their mouth, and they lied unto Him with their tongues. What does that mean? They lied unto Him with their tongues. They said, oh, Lord, we'll follow You. Yay, Lord. And then there they are. Moses is up on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. And there they are. Aaron, hey, make us a god. Didn't you just say that you were going to follow what He told you? You guys just said that, didn't you? They are, make us a god. And then Aaron says, these be thy gods which led thee out of Egypt. And all the people, you know, it says in Numbers it talks about it. And even in the New Testament it says then they rose up to play. There's a lot implied in that. Some wicked, idolatrous acts. And you read, I believe it's in Numbers, where they come down and they slew the people, they kill them. It says they were running around, there were people running around naked. Like, what? Why would they do that? Because of their idolatrous worship that they learned in Egypt. It was all part of these religious rites. So how'd they know who to kill? Because they were naked. They didn't have clothes on. You were the ones that partook of it. And after Moses showed up and said, you need to get things right, these people did not. This is where they were at. This is what was going on. So look, what a rebellious heart. What a wicked heart. When we are corrected by the Word of God, and the Word of God shows us something, and we need to do this, and this is the right thing to do, we look at them and we think, how wicked of them. How wicked of us to sit right here and say we're following God. I love you, Lord. And He corrects us on something. He shows us, you need to do this. This is the right thing. This is what My Word says. And yet we don't do it. We won't change. And we're going to stand there and say, nah, I'm not going to do it. After you've been shown, after the Bible's taught you. Right. We want to separate what we don't do from what they don't do. Right. We say, we're not like them. We're not running around naked, fornicating, calling it religious worship. But ours isn't just as bad when we're ignoring what God says and we won't do what He says. I think that's called religious fornication. We've got another God. You sure you're following the God of the Bible when you won't do what He says? You say, well, I don't believe that. Well, what God are you following then? What God have you made up? Because Christians can have false gods. A saved person can have a false God. So what God are you following? We better make sure it lines up with the book. So that's how they lied to Him with their mouths. Said, oh Lord, we'll follow You. We'll do whatever You say, Lord. You're great. This is amazing. Thank You for bringing us out of Egypt. Thank You for all that You've done. But I'm not going to do that. But You said You'd follow Me. But their heart wasn't right. Someone that is not steadfast will turn back from, tempt, and limit God. Verse 41, Psalm 78, yea, they turned back and tempted God and limited the Holy One of Israel. Man, that's the one thing I fear, limiting God. God says, I wanted to do so much here. I wanted to do so much, but You limited me. And that scares me. That worries me. That's my concern. My prayer often is, Lord, just help me not mess things up. That's what I pray. Lord, don't let me mess this up, please. Because I'm good at that. I'm a good messer-upper. I can do that real good. But Lord, I don't want to do that. Here's what they did. They turned back and tempted God and limited the Holy One of Israel. What they turned back. They forsook God. They turned back. God says, we're going this way. I want you to go this way. And they started to see what, and they said, we'll follow that as they're going this way. But they're still like, yeah, we'll do that. Yeah, we'll, Jehovah, okay, yeah, sacrifice, got it. They still played the part. They were still going through the motions, what God was showing them, but their heart wasn't in it. They turned back and they limited the Holy One of Israel. Do we not do that today? Do we not do that today? Was it evil for them? Was it wicked for them to do that? To tempt God? Then why is it not for us? Why is it not wrong for us to tempt God, to turn our back from Him, to limit Him? They're quick to forget all that He's done for them. They're ungrateful. Psalm 78, verse 42 says, they remembered not His hand, nor the day when He delivered them from the enemy. We're so quick to forget what God has done for us because maybe we've been wronged in some certain situation. So we forget exactly what it is that God has done. We can count, man, that's why that song, I like that song. I wish we had it here. Count your blessings. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. I can't sing, so that's as good as it's going to get right there. But count your many blessings and see all that God's done. Count them. Look at everything that God's done for you. And it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. That's what we have to do. We have to not forget what God has done. They were quick to forget all that God did, and because of that, they got bitter about the present situation that they were in. But God says, wait, don't forget what everything I've done for you. Man, take it back to the cross. Take it back to the gospel and think, man, thank God He saved me. I'm not going to go to hell. You know, you can start getting down on yourself and pity party and feeling, oh God, how come I'm in this situation? Man, just take a lighter and burn your hand real quick. I'm telling you, burn your hand. You think, what is, pastor? He's crazy. Why would you do that? Children don't do that. Adults, okay, you try it. Burn your hand and then remember how bad hell is. When your hand, every time your heart beats, you just feel it throb. Boof, 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 and you feel that pain. Remember how bad hell is. And, oh, God saved me from that. Thank you, Lord. Life is bad, but you're better. Amen. And I'm not going to hell. Amen. Remember that. You burn yourself. And I remember when I used to work on cars doing exhaust. And you know, you'd have the car up on the lift and you're there with a cutting torch and you're cutting it in the slag. Whenever you see someone with a torch, that the sparks you see flying, that's metal pieces falling off. And every once in a while, man, one of those pieces will just poof, right down your shirt. Man, that's awful. That thing's, I mean, it's melted metal, red hot, and that thing falls down your shirt, and all of a sudden you'll just see some guy, he's just shh, and all of a sudden you see him doing this, and he's like, oh, oh, oh. And the worst part is when it comes down here, you just have to burn because you're not going to let it go any farther. So you're just there like, oh! I mean, holding the torch, you can't put it anywhere else. It's bad. And then I'd get home, and my wife would see me, and she'd be like, what is all this, these marks on you? Because it would look like a scratch or something. She'd be like, what is that? And because it rolls down your body. And I'd be like, I burned myself. She's like, mm-hmm. I did. but I mean, think about that pain that you get from a burn and how bad it is. And say, thank God, I don't have to go to hell. God, you're good to me. Remember what He did for you so you can be steadfast and unmovable and always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because I promise you, mark it down, count it right now, life is going to get hard. Unfair things are going to happen to you. Bad situations are going to happen to you. The bottom's going to fall out. You'll lose your job. Someone will get sick. Somebody's going to die. I promise you, it's going to happen. So decide now that God, right now that things are good, I'm going to remember all You've done for me. I'm going to remember how good things are right now. Man, that we can eat like kings. It blows me away. We live like kings. I mean, we are royalty in this country. Think, you go to a restaurant, you have servants bring you food. That's exactly what we call them, servers. You're a servant. You're serving me the food. We have servants bring us food. And we get to eat so much, we throw some away. And whatever we want. We're rich. We're blessed. I mean, man, we ate some good pizza yesterday. And we had servants bring us food. And there was leftovers. And I know some of the crust even got thrown away. Because we have so much. We're blessed. We have, God's given us so much. Rejoice in it. Thank Him for it. Thank Him for everything He's given you. Every moment you have with your family, thank Him for it. Man, I was just thinking the other day, listening to my youngest laughing in our van. Just cracking up laughing. And it was loud. And I was trying to listen to the music. And then I just said, man, I better just enjoy this right now, because the day's coming that I won't hear that anymore. And just thanking God for it. Rejoice in every moment you have. Count your blessings, all that God has done for you. Be steadfast. If we're to be steadfast, we must be in the faith. 1 Peter 5:8 and 9 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour." So the devil's coming after us, so we need to be on alert. He says, "Whom resist steadfast," where? In the faith. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. So because the devil's coming after you, you're to resist him steadfast in the faith. So if we're to remain steadfast, we need to be in the faith. That means the one true faith that we're to earnestly contend for. Not multiple faiths, but the one true faith. It's not only talking about salvation, but a part of what is going on, being in the faith, being a part of what's happening, serving God. I mean, that's what 1 Corinthians 15:58 said, that we would be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. So when we're in the faith, it's talking about all of the faith, but we're in it, we're engaged in it, we're doing something. I mean, we lose the mentality of modern day Christianity that says, if I go to church, I'm a good Christian. Right. No, you're not.
Amen.
It must be more than that.
Right.
Therefore, because all God did for us, I do this.
Amen.
I'm always abounding in the work of the Lord. That's what it's about. I'm in the faith. I'm serving Him in some way, shape, or form. And let me say, that service to Him should be through His church.
That's right.
Not anything else.
Whether
it may be Christian in nature or not, it needs to be through His church, because that's what He died for.
That's right.
That's what He gave Himself for. That's the only institution on earth He established in this, where we're at right now, to get His work done. His kingdom, it's right here.
Amen.
This is it. No parachurch organizations. I know that's all from universal church teaching. That's where it all comes from. We're all the church. Okay, so which... You know, when you have to go tell it to the church, who do you tell it to?
Right.
Just holler it out in the, you know, in the open? Go out in the middle of the street? What do? The local church. This is where God wants to work through.
Amen.
We have to also actively resist the devil. We can't give in to every temptation, but we're to resist. It says, whom resist steadfast in the faith. We resist the devil. We resist the temptations. We will be destroyed if we are unmovable in the wrong location. Think about this. If we're in the wrong location and we're unmovable, we will be destroyed. I'm talking doctrine. If we're wrong in doctrine, in the wrong location, it will destroy us. Turn to Acts 27:41, if you would please. I'm going to make an application from what this is saying. It's a good illustration of what I'm talking about. Acts chapter 27 and verse 41. Paul is being sent to Rome. He's being transported there. He's under arrest. Acts 27, verse 41. We'll start in verse 40. "And when they had taken up the anchors, they committed themselves unto the sea, and loosed the rudder bands, and hoised up the mainsail to the wind, and made toward shore. And falling into a place where two seas met, they ran the ship aground, and the forepart stuck fast, and it remained unmovable." It wasn't moving. "But the hinder part was broken with the violence of the waves." So because it was in the wrong place and it was unmovable, it was broken, it was destroyed. If we're going to want to stay in the wrong place and be hard-hearted and not willing to submit and to follow God, it'll destroy us.
Right.
Especially when once you know the truth. And we can look at doctrinal error and we say, "Well, I'm just not going to do that. My favorite preacher thinks this." Who cares? What does God think?
Amen.
That's what we have to ask ourselves. What does God think? I mean, if I could just encourage you, don't listen to the radio preachers here in town. Anywhere, really. Most of it's, I haven't found anything that's sound in doctrine. There's some things they say are right. And that's the danger. Some things they say are right. But it's all tainted. "Well, I've got a little glass of water here, just 2 drops of arsenic. Any takers?" Say, "No way. But it's just a little tainted." Say, "I don't want to, that'll hurt me. That could kill me. Are you crazy, preacher?" But we'll listen to our favorite radio preacher, televangelist, whatever it is. two drops of false doctrine, it'll kill you. It'll kill you. Don't listen to it. Now, some people might think, you think you're the only one that's right? Well, if I thought I was wrong on something, I'd fix it. I'll tell you that. Amen. Do I know I'm right? I'm wrong on things? Yeah, of course. But when I find that out, I try and change that. That's what 2 weeks ago was about.
Amen.
I found out I was wrong on something, and I said, I need to fix that. I do think I'm right. That's why I teach and preach what I do. If I didn't believe it, I wouldn't teach it. So be careful what we listen to. Be careful what we bring in. If we're to be unmovable, we need to make sure we're in the right place, because if we're in the wrong place, we can be destroyed. We're to be unmovable in sound doctrine. Acts 2:42 says, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrines. No, it doesn't say doctrines. I added that in. It says in the apostles' doctrine. They had one doctrine, one truth that they were following, earnestly contending for the faith. The faith, that's where they were standing. I hope we're not getting tired of hearing about doctrine. That's all they talk about here. Amen. If we can be known as the church that talks about doctrine, I'm okay with that. That's a good thing. Good. Maybe it'll keep the wolves out. Because none of you would be happy with me if we let a wolf in here and he destroyed and devoured some of us. Preacher, how come you didn't kick him out? Well, I didn't want to offend anyone with sound doctrine. You know, we got to help him. He's a wolf. He's seeking to devour the sheep. Man, you know, ranchers, when they get a wolf on their property that's killing their cattle, they start bringing them dog food. No. What do? That's right. Yeah, they die of lead poisoning. Okay, they shoot them. All right, they take them out. You mean they don't let the wolves stick around? No, they don't. Well, that's what a wolf is in the Bible. It's someone that brings in false doctrine to destroy. Now, I'm not saying it can't happen, but if I find out about it, it will be dealt with. We have to. Ephesians 4:14 says that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. So a wolf can get in here. A wolf in sheep's clothing is often what we'll say, and they'll just lie in wait to deceive. They're just waiting for their moment. They're getting on everyone's side. And I'm telling you who they're going to go after. They're going to go after the new Christian or the weak Christian. That's always how they work. That's why God made the analogy. That's what wolves do. They pick off the weak one. The same thing lions. They pick off the weak ones, the sickly ones. They don't want to fight, man. They want an easy meal. I mean, they don't want to have to work for it. That's why we go out to eat so often, right? How many of us go out to eat? How many of you have planned a meal at home? You're like, this is what we're making. And then like whatever dad or whoever gets home from work and it's like, well, let's just go get something. Who has ever done that? Is that just our family? Everyone's here? Okay, I think probably most of us have done that. Why? Because, man, it's easier. I don't want to have to do all that work, and then you got to clean it up and all of that stuff too. Let's just go get something. It's faster. Right? Well, that's the same way how a wolf is going to work. The easiest meal they can get. So it says they lie in wait to deceive. They're waiting for that. So he talks about in Ephesians 4, verse, you take it up to verse 11. Brother Woody was teaching about this, and he said this is why he's given pastors and evangelists and teachers for the perfecting of the saints. To perfect the saints, to mature the saints, to grow them. Why? So they're not children tossed to and fro. Because they're steadfast. Because they're unmovable. Because they know what they believe.
Amen.
So when false doctrine comes in here, and now look, I'm saying everyone can say something false, and hopefully we don't let false doctrine come in here. But I mean, there's been a few times preachers that have been in here have said something false. And I probably most of you didn't catch it, but I did. But even when we get to that, when we get to that point, I hope you'd understand and you'd say that was false. And you just recognize it and wouldn't be deceived by it. So hopefully I just keep that out, though. That's the plan. Amen. All right, our stand in the gospel is strengthened by actively serving the Lord. It says there, go back to 1 Corinthians 15, please. It says that, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. We're to abound in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So if our stand in the gospel is to be strengthened, it's to be strengthened by actively serving God, to abound in the work of the Lord. If we're abounding, we must love God supremely. Jesus said in Matthew 22:37, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. Do you think you're going to turn your back on Him when you love Him with all your soul, all your mind, all your heart? You think you're not going to serve Him when you love Him with everything you've got? No, you're not going to turn your back on Him. You're going to serve Him when you love Him like you should. We have to love God supremely. If we love Him, we'll have no problem serving Him. If we love God, we will not have a problem serving Him. Look, if you serve God, you're going to have to sacrifice. You are going to have to sacrifice. I mean, I've talked to some people, tried to even invite them over to our house, wanted to feed them. And they said, no, Sunday's my day. Like, mad. I was like, well, okay, sir. We just wanted to, like, feed you a meal. It's okay. But I'm serious. They got mad. Well, do you think they love God supremely? I don't know their heart, but sure doesn't seem like it. Sure doesn't seem like it. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. 1 John 5:3, for this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. So it's our reasonable service. It's reasonable is what the Lord's saying. It's possible. This to abound in the work of the Lord is a call to be actively engaged in promoting and advancing His kingdom. That's what it is, to abound in the work of the Lord. We're advancing the Lord's kingdom. That's what we're to do. The work of the Lord is that which He requires of us. And here's what He requires of us. He says we're to study the Word of God. I'm just going to hit on a few things right here. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Come on in, you're welcome in. So if we are to do the work of the Lord, then we need to study the Word of God. We need to rightly divide the word of truth. We're to reach others with the gospel. If you're in 1 Corinthians 15, look at verse 34. I love this. This is such a challenge to me. He says right here, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. He says, some don't know about God. Some don't know what God's done for them. He says, I speak this to your shame. Awake to righteousness. See, it's a righteous thing to tell others about the Lord, to tell them their need of a Savior. That's what we're celebrating today, is the death, burial, and resurrection of our Savior. The word itself, Savior, even means that you're in need of help, that you can't do it yourself. If you could do it yourself, you wouldn't need a Savior. We need a Savior. Why? Because we're in a predicament we can't get ourselves out of. The Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. If you've ever told a lie, you're a liar. If you've ever stolen anything, you're a thief. The value doesn't matter. I mean, I was talking with somebody yesterday about this and talking about being a thief. And he said, oh, no, I've never done that. I said, well, have you ever taken like 3 minutes extra break at work? He said, well, yeah, but I made it up in other places. I'm like, well, wasn't your employer paying you for it? He said, well, yeah. I said, so you stole from him? He said, well, and then he told me he was with the city. And I'm like, oh, I know you don't work for free with the city, because I worked with the city. I'm like, nobody in the city does that. I'm like, my union contract says this. I'm not working for you if I'm not on the clock. Nobody does that. He's a thief. He admitted he was a thief. I mean, you take it back to when you're a child. You take something that doesn't belong to you. You're a thief. Your mama tells you, don't get that cookie, and you take that cookie, you're a thief. It ain't yours. It's not yours. You're a thief. You ever taken God's name in vain? Everyone today, OMG, OMG, I hate that. I don't even like saying that. I feel like that's blasphemous to even say that, because everybody knows what it means. So we say that and we're blaspheming God's name. We're taking something holy and special and we're like spitting on it. That's what we do when we do that. And God says He's not going to hold him guiltless that taketh His name in vain. You ever hated anybody? You're a murderer. You're a murderer in God's eyes. God says if you hate your brother, you're a murderer. Well, if it applies to your brother, I'm sure it applies to your neighbor and to your friend and to the stranger. If you hate somebody, you are a murderer. You say, I've never killed anybody, not me. I'm not a bad person. Well, then you're just disagreeing with God. It doesn't matter, because He's the one that's going to judge you. As it's appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. Once we die, we're going to stand before Him. He's going to judge us, not based on what we think is right, but based on what He says is right. It don't matter what you think. You say, well, that's not fair. He says, I don't care. You don't make the rules, I do. I mean, how many of us, when our children argue with us, Well, I didn't ask you. This is just how it is.
Amen.
You're just going to do what I said. I told you not to do that and you didn't listen. Doesn't matter. But. Doesn't matter. You're in trouble. I mean, try that with a judge. You murdered somebody and, well, I haven't done it again. I've been a good person since then. You know, I only killed 3 people. But that was 10 years ago. I haven't done it since then. So, oh, well, man, bailiff, take the handcuffs off. Let him out. Why are we here? You know, man, I could have been slept in today. Judges don't do that, do they? Say, no, you're guilty. You broke the law and there's a punishment for it.
Amen.
And that's a predicament every one of us in here is in. We're guilty of breaking God's law. And because we've broken His law, when we stand before Him as a judge, He's going to give us exactly what we deserve. Grab your Bible, go to Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter number 2. It says right here, Romans 2:5. But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, see, we buck God, we fight God. God says this, we're like, I don't care. We got a hard heart and impenitent. Nothing gets through to it. I'm not listening to that. And God says, after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasurest up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. God says, every time you sin, you're just storing up my wrath. But I thought God was a God of love. He is. If you come to Him on His terms.
Amen.
That's why repentance is so important. He says, there is coming a day of wrath, and there's going to be a revelation of His righteous judgment. And then verse 6 says, when on that day of His righteous judgment, He says He's going to render to every man according to his deeds. God will give to every one of us according to our deeds. And if you're a liar, a thief, a murderer, a blasphemer, disobedient to your parents, an adulterer, whatever it is, if you're any of those things, He's going to give you what you deserve, and it's going to be the lake of fire. Because He says, even in Revelation chapter 20, He says, all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire. Revelation 21:8. Every liar, if you've told one lie, you're a liar and you're going to the lake of fire. Because God sees sin that serious. But we don't like to see it that serious. No, everyone tells lies. I'm not that bad. Here's what else God says. Go to Romans 8:7. Actually, we'll start in verse 6. He says, for to be carnally minded, Romans 8:6, for to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So there's a difference there, spiritual mind and the carnal mind. The carnal mind is what we are in our flesh. Just what you are when you're born. You have the carnal mind. When you are brought into this life, you have the carnal mind.
Amen.
Look at toddlers. I mean, when they play, I mean, they're just no holds barred. I mean, if you took my candy, I'm gouging your eye out. That was my toy. I'm just whap, give it to me, bam. I mean, they'll bite you. I mean, you ever had a toddler bite you? Those little monsters, they come up to you, you think they're holding your hand because you're talking to an adult or something, and then they just gnaw on your finger. You're like, ah, what are you doing? This little kid just, you're like, you little monster. I mean, man, that's just carnality. They just do what feels good. That's mine. Don't take that from me. And they just start screaming, kicking, throwing a tantrum. I mean, that's the carnal mind, the flesh. The flesh at its max. And it says, to be carnally minded is death. Verse 7, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. Your carnal mind, your fleshly mind is at enmity against God. That means you are the enemy of God. Before you get saved, every one of us in here is the enemy of God. If you're not saved right now, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, right now you're His enemy. You think, not me, I love God. If you have never trusted Christ as your Savior, you've never been born again, you are God's enemy, His wrath abides on you, and when you die and stand before Him because you're a lawbreaker, He will throw you straight into hell.
Amen.
Straight into hell, and you deserve it. You deserve it. Because you're His enemy. But thank God for a Savior, amen?
Amen.
Thank God for a Savior. Died on the cross and rose from the dead to give us victory. Victory over death. Victory over sin. He took care of it. He paid the penalty. And He offers us the free gift of eternal life. He says it's there for anybody. Any wicked, evil sinner can take it. I mean, Hitler, as wicked as he was, had he received it, God would have saved him. God would have saved him. No matter how bad you are. God says, I love you so much, I'll die for you. And I'll take your place. I'll take all your sin on me. That's what 2 Corinthians 5:21 talks about. For He who knew no sin became sin for us. He took all of our sin on Him. Every lie you've ever told, every envious thought you've ever had, every lustful thought, every hateful thought, everything. He took it all on Him. Every evil deed you've ever done. The gossip, when you're just slandering someone, just trashing them. He took all that on Him. And what we talked about earlier, when He was there on that cross, suffocating, it was for you, for me, for our sin. He was paying our sin debt. He took our sin on Him so that we, the rest of the verse says, could be made the righteousness of God in Him, so we could have His sinlessness placed on top of us and our sins washed away. And when we have that, God no longer sees our sin. He sees His sinless Son, and we have victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And we die, we get to be with the Lord. Because our sins are, they were dealt with at the cross, and we appropriated the gift. We received the gift. And that's how salvation works. It's there, it's offered to everybody, just like this is, pretend this is the gift of salvation. It's there for everybody, it's being offered to everybody, and if we will just but receive it, it's ours. And God says, I died for you, I loved you, will you take this gift? Will you receive it? We have to come to Him on His terms. And it's through repentance and faith. Except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. There's a lot of people that believe in God, but they have no repentance. They've not turned from their way. They've not surrendered to the Lord. They're still fighting Him. They're still His enemy. And God told them, you need to turn from this sin. You need to stop doing that. You need to stop drinking. You need to stop lying. Whatever it is. I don't know what it is. Different for everybody. But I promise you, He's convicting you of something. He's showing you, you need to repent of this. And if people don't do that, there's no salvation. Except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. You will die and go to hell. So the gift is there, but repentance has us we're facing this way and we need repentance. The gift is there, right there. God says, if you want it, take it. It's yours. You can have it. Just take it. Go ahead. But if we're unwilling to repent, we're still facing this way. You can't get to it. We can't come and get the gift like this because you can't have it. You have to repent. So if we're facing this way, we say, I want my sin, I want to keep this, I'm not willing to give that up, and God told you, you need to give that up, you can't have that gift. Because you're facing the wrong way. Repentance, it's a surrender. It's a, okay, because we're saying, I don't want that. God, get your hand off my shoulder, stop pulling on me. God, I'm not listening to that. We're fighting Him, we're His enemy. And repentance says, I surrender. God's tugging on our shoulder, and we just say, oh, okay, Lord. God, you're right. You're right, God. And we turn. And now we're in a position we can receive the gift. And He says it's through repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now we've turned to Him so we can get to it. And now we put the faith and we come to it. And we say, Lord, give me that. Please, I need your salvation. I need your forgiveness. And He offers the gift and He gives us the gift. And it's mine now. And it's the gift of eternal life. Eternal. It means I can't lose it. Either God's lying to me or He's telling the truth. Either He gave me eternal life or He didn't. But now that it's mine, God says, you're mine for eternity, and I have the gift. It's there for you if you'll receive it. Have you done that? Have you been born again? Have you trusted Christ as your Savior? He died for you. That's what Resurrection Sunday is all about. We're focusing on the resurrection, the victory we can have through Christ, that we're always... we're steadfast, unmovable, and always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because of the cross, we're steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. But being those things doesn't matter if you're not saved. Oh, Jesus said you must be born again. You must. You must. Have you trusted Christ as your Savior? If so, when? When did you do it? That's what's before you today. If you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, I challenge you, trust Him. Call out to Him. Receive Him as your Savior. You can pray right there in your seat even right now. Say, God, I need you. Save me. Just like I showed you right there, just coming to Him, broken, and saying, Lord, I need that gift. Give it to me. Please, Lord, save me. Forgive me of my sins. And He'll do it. He says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's a promise from the Lord. He says He'll save you. Will you let Him? Christians, are you steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord? Always. That means there's joy in your heart. Joy isn't dependent on circumstances. If you're abounding in the work of the Lord, there's joy. Let's pray.